Hi everyone, I'm Adriana, and in this tutorial, we're gonna learn how to make a thin layer of golden butter cake using a half sheet pan. So I use this cake to make my little mini cakes. I use it to make my number cakes. You can be really creative with this size of cake, and we'll be using the recipe from my Cakeulator, which is an app on my website that calculates custom cake recipes. So this is a video series that I'm developing alongside coding the app, which will help bakers become more efficient in the kitchen. So I thought we'd start off first by checking out the app and printing out the recipe, and then moving on into the kitchen where we're gonna bake some cake. So I thought I'd briefly go over how to use the Cakeulator to calculate a cake size for you, but you can definitely use a box cake mix or your own recipe and just use my technique for making layer cakes. But if you wanna use the Cakeulator, you just go to the website and go to the Cakeulator page, and you can pick the flavor, the size, or the frosting flavor for the type of cake that you wanna make. So the type of flavors that I have available right now are golden vanilla, brown butter vanilla, chocolate, and lemon cake. And you can also choose various sizes. You can choose cupcakes, you can use 8-inch rounds to make up to 4 layers of cake, or you can use the half sheet pan, which I have right here. And then I have a few frosting flavors loaded into the app. So for this particular video, I'm going to use the golden vanilla cake to make a half sheet thin cake, and I'm not gonna print any frosting. I'm not gonna make any frosting this time because I'm just gonna try to make the cake. So all you have to do is push submit, and the app will calculate the recipe for you, as well as some preliminary information on your choices. So a little bit of info on the vanilla cake, the size, and then some advice on how to stack them if you want, or if you want to use it for number cakes, and then some frosting advice. So here is the recipe itself, and the app calculates all of these amounts for you. So I'm still working out the bugs, but this is still very precise. I usually bake in grams, and so the recipe is based off of grams that then gets converted into volume. So you'll often see things like 10 tablespoons of whole milk, but if you can convert that into cups, that's like 8 tablespoons equals a half cup, so it's a half cup plus 2 tablespoons. Or you can just measure out 10 tablespoons of whole milk, but I highly suggest that you follow the weight measurements if you can. However, the volume is still incredibly accurate. Okay, and then we have the custom instructions based on the pan size that you chose, and then some assembly and decorating advice, like if you want to use mini cakes or large cakes. Oftentimes I'm going to post a video so that you can follow along with the video and then the recipe itself. That's the recipe. You can print it out if you want, or you can go in the website and actually, you know, it's an interactive kind of thing. You check off the ingredients as you use them, but let's move on into the kitchen where I'll show you how I use this recipe. Okay, after setting out all of your ingredients to room temperature, such as your butter, eggs, and milk, and preheating the oven, the next thing to do is prepare the pan. So here I have a half sheet pan, and I'm just going around the edges with some butter, and then using a little bit on the bottom so that we can adhere a piece of parchment paper to it. So I had to cut this to fit, but sometimes they have pre-cut parchment. Either one works. Prepare the edges a bit by pouring a little bit of the flour that you're using in the recipe and shifting it all around the pan so that the sides are coated. All right, to your mixer, add your butter and beat that on medium speed until it reaches a mayonnaise-like consistency. And while that's going, I typically like to make the flour mixture, which is just cake flour, a little bit of baking powder and salt, and give that a good whisk for at least 30 seconds to evenly distribute the baking powder. And then set that aside while you prepare your milk mixture, which is room temperature milk and room temperature sour cream. Use a fork to whisk that completely. You want to make sure that the sour cream is completely combined into the milk. Otherwise, you might get these unsightly holes in your cake. And when your butter is nice and soft, go ahead and add your granulated sugar and vanilla extract, and you're gonna want to beat this until it's a little bit fluffy, but it's still gonna be pretty sandy because it's mostly made of sugar, for about 3 to 5 minutes. Stop the mixer and then give it a good scrape at least once during this process, and then you're going to add in the canola oil and let that beat for another 2 minutes,
and the mixture will get slightly lighter in color and in texture. Now turn your mixer on low speed and add your egg yolks one at a time, making sure that the previous yolk has been completely mixed in before you add the next one. And if you're ever wondering why we always do this step when we make cakes, it's because egg yolks are a really fascinating ingredient. They're called emulsifiers, which means they have this ability to pull fat molecules and water-based molecules together in a really unique way. So go ahead and give your bowl a good scrape to make sure that no egg yolks are left in the bottom, and at which point we will start adding in the whole eggs. So it's the same process. You want to add in one egg at a time, ensure that it's completely mixed in the bowl before you add the next egg. Then stop the mixer and give it a good scrape. And it might seem like we're scraping a lot, but scraping is actually a very important part of making cakes. You want to make sure that the previous ingredient has been completely incorporated into the batter before moving on to the next ingredient. All right, and the last step is to alternate flour and milk. So take your flour mixture and pour in half into the bowl, and then on low speed, allow your mixer to pretty much mix it all in, but see how I stopped the mixer and there's still flour on the outside? So take your scraper and mix all of the flour in before you move to the next step. If you don't do the scraping, what you risk doing is mixing the next ingredient, which is milk and sour cream, with the flour, which is not what we want. We want to mix the milk and sour cream into the batter, which already has the flour mixed in. Okay, so now here is the milk and sour cream mixture, and we're gonna pour in half of that and make sure that's completely mixed into the batter before we mix in the flour again. And then here we go again with our scrapity scrape to make sure that the milk has been mixed into the batter. And then we're gonna pour in half of the flour again, half of whatever was left from the first pour, and then mix that in. And then here we go with Mr. Scrapey spatula, and then we're gonna pour in the other half of the sour cream mixture, and then mix that in. And then give it a good scrape before adding in all of the rest of your flour to finish off. And then give your batter one last stir with the spatula to make sure that all the flour has been mixed in. You don't want to overmix at this point, but you just want to make sure that there's no flour left on the sides and bottom of the bowl. Then take your batter and pour it into your prepared half sheet pan. You can then use the spatula to even out the surface to make sure that the entire bottom surface is covered. You want to try to get an even distribution of cake batter because it's so thin, so any kind of deviation in the height is going to cause certain places to rise in more places than others. So just make sure that you can try to get it as even as possible. So you can kind of jiggle the pan a little bit and this will help kind of distribute the batter evenly. And you also want to give it two or three firm taps on the countertop to remove the large air bubbles. All right, place your pan in the middle of an oven that's been preheated to 350 degrees for about 20 to 23 minutes, although you should start checking at around 15 to 18 minutes. You'll know the cake is done when it's slightly brown on top like this. You can check the internal temperature of the cake, which is a little bit difficult to do because it's so thin, but it should register around 205 degrees Fahrenheit. You can also use a skewer, but like I said, it's kind of difficult to do because the cake is so thin. So if you go in at an angle, sometimes you can catch more of the crumbs or kind of assess the doneness of the cake. You can also just use your hand. And you'll get a feel for cakes when they're done. They kind of have a little bit of resistance, but if you push on them, they'll leave the slightest indentation and then kind of bounce back. So you can totally serve this cake in the pan with some frosting and sprinkles, but if you want to remove the cake from the pan to make like mini cakes or number cakes, you have to let the cake cool completely or like 90%. It can be a little warm, but definitely not hot from the oven. And then you run a butter knife along the edges and then take a cooling rack or another pan that's large and flip it over. And the cake should fall out if you loosen the edges properly, which I did not manage to do in this shot, but I wanted to show you that sometimes cake is hard to get out. So just take your knife and go around the edges again and see how I caught some corners that kind of crusted over. Just make sure those are loose and then you'll be able to flip it out. All right, let's try that again. Okay, flip it over, and you should hear a soft sound when the cake hits the cooling rack or pan, which we have here. And then so all you need to do is pull off the parchment paper backing. Unless you're using this cake right away, and because it has so much surface area exposed, you're going to want to cover this baby up. So manipulating a cake that's this large and thin can be difficult, but I'm going to show you how I wrap it in saran wrap. So I just take one layer of saran wrap and place it on the bottom, and then take another large platter or cooling rack like I have here and flip it over. So you always want to use something large to manipulate this cake until it's frozen. And that's how I cut it into little shapes or the large letters. You never really want to try to use it when it's soft like this from the oven, because it's gonna break. So if I'm putting this cake in the freezer, I'll just flip it back into a half sheet pan and freeze it like that so it freezes flat, or I'll just leave it out at room temperature for a couple days until I'm ready to use it. It should remain pretty fresh like that. It can remain in the freezer for at least a couple weeks until you're ready to use it. So here's a shot of me actually flipping the cake into a pan so that I can freeze it. It's from another cake that I was making that same day, but I just thought I'd show you guys so you know what it looked like. So this is how I make my thin layer cake. For all of the recipes on my blog using the Cakeulator, go ahead and check out that app on my blog, Tasty Pastry Kitchen. And if you have any flavor recommendations for the app, go ahead and leave a comment below. I'm always trying to make my app more helpful for bakers, so any comments are really appreciated. Thanks and have a great day.